This is where it all started for me. 1959 tops, the first vintage set I acquired and at one time completed. I won it as part of an in-person auction back in 1998. The set was missing just 5 cards, including all 3 Mickey Mantles. Within a calendar year, I'd found those cards and stamped the quest a success. The following year, I acquired 3 other vintage sets, and I was off and running never to look back. Well, I did look back through these cards, and as beautiful as they are and look together, some have small issues and a few others have variations which are needed. When I first purchased this set, I was not aware of the no trade and option statements and the printing of different birth dates. We'll get to those in a minute. The set boasts 572 base cards and 9 additional varieties. Certain series have the backs printed on either a cream or dark gray stock. High numbers, 507 to 572, are tougher to obtain than the rest. The key rookie is number 514, Bob Gibson, which is very difficult to find centered. The original example that was part of my auction-winning set was hugging the top border. I sold that one and used the funds towards this, which is deemed a 6.5 by PSA. Other notable cards included are the return of Sporting News All-Stars, the first inclusion of rookie prospect cards, Baseball Thrills, Commissioner Fort Frick on the very first card, and a salute to Roy Campanella. Quick fact, number 440 Lou Burdette shows him posing as a left-handed pitcher, even though he threw righty. The image isn't reversed, so he's most likely pulling a prank on the photographer and all of us. Another note on the entire set, all player names were printed in lowercase lettering, tops seemingly ahead of their time in the graphics department. Besides needing to upgrade a Giants team card, I've struggled with this version of Sparky Anderson's rookie, where he's introduced as George. The front presents so well, I've yet to find another that really catches my eye. What my eyes can't stand is the pen mark on the back. Somehow it never sat well with me. There have been other examples I've purchased without any such marks, but the quality of this one for some reason makes me keep it. For a sharper card, I'll have to shell out a few more bucks. Those are the base needs, and I'm looking for 3 more variations to make a master set complete. 5 cards, numbered between 316 and 362, are found with and without club option or trade statements on the reverse. You have to really search for them to notice, for the backs tend to get busy with stats and cartoons. But once you become familiar, they become easy to find. Billy Lowe's number 336 is the only one that eludes me. Haywood Sullivan's card number 416 comes with 3 printing variants in its copyright information. The first has the correct copyright symbol with a circle around the letter C. Another has no circle, and yet a third version has no circle and no dot after the A in USA. Finally, here's Warren Spahn, and just how old is he? One version of his card number 40 lists his birthday correctly as April 23, 1921. 2 other versions list his year of birth as 1931, and one of those can be found with the year obscured via a skip in the printing. But wait, isn't that similar to the 1958 Herrera? In any case, the 2 errors are still on my want list, and for a total of just 5 cards needed to officially finish off the set that started it all, that's not bad. Check out future videos which will follow and update my progress in finishing this and other vintage sets. Here are the current totals for cards needed as part of my 1950s collection. In the next video, we'll go horizontal again as the 1960 top set kicks off a fun decade for collectors. Thanks for watching.